Yeah, if anybody gives you any shit, just beat the fuck out of them.
It happens to so many women, you know, when it happens in your home behind closed doors with someone you love, it's not this straightforward. If a stranger did this, it would be a no-brainer. If I hadn't had a few people that I really trust around me, a few women, if I hadn't had them around me, how different my life would be.
I don't have to start yelling. I think I start yelling once it gets fucking heightened. I've gotten a lot better about that. It's just only, yelling when it's fucking hour 11 and we're really in it.
Yeah, you haven't gotten better about that. Otherwise we wouldn't have had 3 physical fights in the last month and a half, two months.
Sorry about the yelling. But
one time, Johnny was hitting me, and he was hitting me hard and repeatedly, and I was screaming. Security walks in, and they don't do anything about it. And there, he makes this motion when Jerry Judge yells, "Fox." Or Sean, I can't remember who it was, and all we had was a little bit of separation, and my sister runs down the stairs. We're on a landing in between two flights of stairs.
Miss Heard, many times when we fought, not many times. He hit me for a very long time before I ever.
I'm gonna
picked up my arms.
I was trying to escape from a room where Johnny was attacking me, and in order to escape, I was trying to get onto the other side of the door, attempting to close the door, and he was attempting to get in despite my attempts to try and escape.
Inside, Depp listened as text messages were read that he allegedly sent to actor friend Paul Bettany in 2013, saying, "Let's burn Amber." Depp's alleged texts get even more graphic as the day goes on. "Let's drown her before we burn her. I will bleep her burnt corpse afterwards to make sure she is dead." And in 2014, around the time Depp was accused of abusing Amber on a flight, he allegedly sent another text chain to Bettany. "No food for days, powders, half a bottle of whiskey, 1,000 Red Bull and vodkas, pills, 2 bottles of Champers on plane, and what do you get? An angry aggro engine in a bleeping blackout, screaming obscenities and insulting any bleep who got near. I'm done."
I said this in Australia, so I feel like it's so good for so long. We talk about the
truth. Cool. Well, it's the same for me. It's the same for me.
And you kicked and kicked and kicked.
So I need the same things.
So
but when you start flipping out, and I can't get a word in, and it's you know, manic and angry. What the f***, Amber?
I get angry. I'm human. This is the kind of situation where one gets angry.
Okay, but you can't provoke anger in me then.
Just try. You're a hypocrite. You don't do anything that you actually do. You expect from people what you can't give them. If they do something, a taste of it to you, you f***ing lose it. But yet you dish it out.
I left last night, Oz. Honestly, I swear to you. Because I just couldn't take the idea of more physicality, more physical abuse on each other. Because had we continued, it would have gotten bad. And baby, I told you this once, and I'm scared to death of it. We are a crime scene waiting to happen if we don't get our together. And that, there can be no physical violence towards each other.
I agree about the physical violence, but separating for a day or night and taking a night off from our marriage.
No. All I'm saying is, we need to take whatever time we need, you need, or I need, to kind of let things settle for a minute. So that we don't kill each other, or worse, you know, like really kill each other, or break up or whatever, if the fight escalates to the point of where it's just insulting for both of us, or if it gets to that physical the violence.
All I remember is him screaming these expletives at my friend Io and telling her that she could have me now, and then he threw his arm back and he threw the phone, what appeared to be very as hard as he could, at my face. Put my head down. I said, "You hit me." I was crying. I said, "Johnny, hit me," because then I start hearing things being smashed, and I said to him, "Honey, you hit me in the eye, my eye. And I start crying, and he approaches me, and I don't know feeling him approach, anticipate to try to get up, or if I help him help me up, or if he just did it all by grabbing my hair. But for some reason, I had some aid in getting up off the couch by him grabbing my head, mostly on my right side, the impact of which was significant in and of itself. He grabs my grabs my head, takes a fistful of my hair and says, I hit your eye, huh? Let me see your eye. What if I pull your hair back? And he yanks my head back, and he's, I don't know, smacking my face or moving my face, or, and he's got me by the hair, and he's, it's hard to describe. It's like yanking me from side to side with my hair.
Are you standing up at this time?
Yeah.
Okay. And has he pulled out any hair from your head?
He's still holding on to my head.
Okay.
At this time, and he said, I don't know if he's trying to grab my face or if he's hitting my face or I don't know what's happening, but he's yelling at me, he's screaming. Let's see how hard I hit you, and I'm screaming at the top of my lungs.
Okay.
Help! Please help! I guess I say call 911. I'm screaming for help, not just in case Io is on the phone, which I don't know because the phone is somewhere after hitting my face. I don't know where it ricocheted and bounced off to, but it's on the floor. I can only hope she's on the line, but I know and guess security is somewhere, and even though they never respond when I'm screaming help, ever, I'm screaming help as loud as I can. I had also text Rocky previous. It's amping up. He's getting crazy again. Please, just, I need you to come over, because I thought another third party might be, a third party being present helps. Always
Is it your testimony?
Calm things.
Can we take a break, please?
No.
She's upset. She's crying and she's upset, Blair. How could you possibly force her to answer questions when she's crying and upset?
Because not upset and hasn't requested.
Do you I'm requesting on her behalf.
Has heard?
Yes.
Yes.
Let the record reflect Mr. Harder is answering for Ms. Heard, yes, and Ms. Heard has responded, yes. We'll take a break and go off record at this
point. We've been on our honeymoon and we had a great time other than the fact that we had a fight in the train, which was physical. But then we had a fight in San Francisco. But I thought everything else was great. You're saying we've been pondering this since Australia. I also have to thank my my wife, Amber, for putting up with me, for living with all these characters, which can't be easy. It's hard for me. It's got to be hard for her, you know. anyway, I want to thank my wife, Amber.
and you're claiming that Sean Betts and Jerry Judge stood there and did nothing, though, while this was happening, correct?
They weren't there the whole time.
During the period they were there, your claim is that, that they did nothing, correct?
They walked in, and most of it had been done. He'd already charged at me, to which Raquel threw herself in between us, put her arms up to protect us. He'd already pushed Raquel's arms away, intimidated her. We're both back down on the couch. He's protecting me, and he's screaming at me at the top of his lungs, which is what I can only guess served as the impetus to get Jerry Judge and Sean into the room. While he's screaming at me, I'm looking down, and he's screaming at me, taking a step closer and screaming louder each time. Get the f*** up, Amber. Get the f*** up. Get the f*** up. Amber, you hear me? Get the f*** up. And I can only imagine, because it was so loud towards the end, that they came in. I can't tell you the exact moment. Was it at the third threat or the tenth threat when they walked in? But at some point they walked in, and he turned his head, and I hopped up off the couch, ran to the side corner of the room, and said, "Jerry, help me! If he hits me one more time, I will call the police."
In terms of the broken glass, you claim was on your bedroom floor. Could you describe specifically where it was on your bedroom floor, relative to your bed?
It was around my bed, because the paint, and probably by the entrance of the door as well, but I'm not exactly sure. Okay. There was a lot of fighting and a lot of movement in several different parts of our room. So when he was holding me down on the bed and I was trying to stand up, that was by the bath, closer to the bathroom, and I know there was broken glass there. When I tried to get out of the bedroom door, and he blocked it and shoved me back down to the floor by the entrance of the door, and I can't remember what else was breaking or what had been knocked over. I know the lamp broke as well. I didn't mention that. It's still in the storage closet I just saw it the other day, and it has wine on it. I found it.
What happened? What happened? Nothing happened this morning, you know that?
Were you in here?
No.
So then nothing happened to you this morning?
Yeah, you're right. I just woke up and you were so sweet and nice. We were not even fighting this morning. All I did was say sorry.
Did something happen to you this morning? I don't think so.
No. That's the thing.
You want to see crazy? I'll give you fucking crazy. That's crazy. Oh, you're crazy. Oh, you're crazy.
Yeah, have you drunk this whole thing this morning?
Oh, you got this. You got this going?
I just started it.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Really?
Proceeding.
I did my best to defend myself and not get seriously hurt or be a doormat to whom this happens to all the time.
I've been trying to protect you.
You told Io to call the cops.
While it was happening?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, because the last time that it got crazy between us, I really did think I was going to lose my life, and I thought you would do it on accident. And I told you that. I said, oh my god, I thought the first...
Do you believe all this?
Calling the f***? Yes, yes!
You believe I'm an abuser?
Yes.
You believe I'm an abuser?
What happened to me?
point out the fact of why I said call 911. Because I was, you had your hands on me after you threw a phone in my face, and I just got crazy in the past, and I truly thought I need to stop this madness before I get hurt.
Oh my God.
And I never, your security guard, which by the way was a follow-up to your security guard thing they never saw abuse happening, the same security guard who, by the way, have said to me multiple times that I was going to get killed. And once, on accident, I had the phone recording out on the table from one of our sites where we're, you know, doing the thing where we record it, and we finished, walked away, whatever, and I kept Jerry Judge on making calls after that, which I didn't even know I had done. I had dropped my phone out on the table in the same room we were having a fight and then left the room. And then Jerry's on the phone. It's him saying that he did not acknowledge any physical violence. You have no idea how bad this is going to be for every single person that has come on the record. Now, there is record of now Jerry and Sean saying that, both of which I can prove heard. Acknowledged.
There's also Travis. There's Travis coming to get me. There's Travis having to come up and pull me away from you.
Yeah, but that's you saying that to Travis. That's different from Jerry Judge saying to going on record saying he never witnessed any violence, and then me having a phone call conversation recorded of him saying exactly that. Not to mention multiple times where they, and they'll have to do this under oath, obviously. They're going to have to say they didn't see it in front of me and other people that have heard them.
You're going to have to do this under oath too, you know.
Understand that the pictures I have match with like text messages to my mom back and forth about it, you know, and text messages between, say, Raquel and my mom, or Raquel and my dad, or, you know, between my two friends. Or there's a text message where I tell Jody the night before I had that James Corden night show thing, where I say, hey, Jody, I've had an accident. I think I have a busted lip. I may have a busted nose and two black eyes tomorrow because I don't know how bad it will be until the morning and we may have to cancel. But I don't know how I'm icing it. I just, I'll let you know in the morning, you know, and things like that. It doesn't matter. There is nothing, and all of that won't be me throwing you in the bus. That will be evidence in this case, which I will have, it will be criminal as well, because I cannot, and it makes you so angry.
You have not let up. You keep blaming, no, what you just said, you're defending yourself against me about something I didn't do, and I'm not going to fight with you because I know this lasts forever.
I did it! I said I could expect it next! I am defending myself.
Excuse me, I'll be right...
I am defending myself.
Excuse me,
I'm defending myself to you on the phone right now, and you're attacking me.
Excuse me, I'll be right back.
To me on top of it.
Can you give me 1 minute, please? May I have 1 minute, please? I'll be right back.
It's not about that. It would not be about me throwing you under the bus. You know what it would be? It would be released through documented people coming on the record and having the protection to do so that haven't had yet. It would be eyewitness statements. It would be evidence, tons of it. And it would be through years. And it would be unbelievable, to imagine that either, I mean, through all these years where I have corroborating text messages between people that match those dates of those timestamps, validated photos of I would either corroboration between people hearing us or corroboration of next day, you know, Whitney sending text message to Kevin, him responding, or, you know, the kind of stuff like between me and people in your life. It is insanely cross-corroborated then.
Amber, I didn't call you those things. I didn't call you those things.
It is all from your side, and you don't believe me, then why are we talking? It's so pointless to even talk like we trust or love or respect each other at all if you don't believe me what I'm saying. And you know it. And I know you.
You
respect you too much to pretend for a second that you don't know these things. On Friday and file without filing a police statement first. And the only reason I haven't filed that police statement, which has been used against me, by the way, every day. And the only reason I won't do it, I haven't done it, is because I don't want to hurt you, and that means it goes out of my hands. And every, yeah, the third party guy, third party prosecutor come, and a criminal lawyer come, and they went, like, the problem is, hearing from you, like, your biggest struggle is that this is just, this is such a, it's the most solid evidence case of domestic violence I've ever seen. And if you give this over to them or present any part of it, it's, they will prosecute him. And I felt like I would never for you. Because I don't even, it's hard for me to even understand. I don't call myself, like, it's not in my head. It's hard for me to even accept any sort of victimdom ever. And
Amber, listen, I understand. Yeah.
And I, when they came, I did not cooperate with them. It has been used against me, not by the media, by your side. Who said, look.
What do you mean? Where's the media? It's all out in the media. Why is my.
DMZ is in your pocket and you don't even know it? Oh, I mean, it's. Well, I was at the courthouse while TMZ is posting things. At the courthouse, while I'm at the courthouse, they're posting things about the cops never coming, right? Then we provide proof. Then they say, oh, just one set of police officers. Then they retract their story, but they don't actually retract it like an objective media source would. No, what do? They just come out with a new lie. They go, oh, well, it was just one pair of cops, and she said it was two. And I said, no, here's the proof. We just subpoenaed the building for the actual security records to prove that was wrong. Okay, then what did they do? They came out with a new lie, a different lie. Okay, well, it was this. It was this. I mean, every step of the way I've had to take has been because that news source is in Marty's pocket, in Laura, like, that's from Laura's source.
Okay.
I've been able to knock you off of your feet.
You started.
Off your balance.
You started these things.
Who are you? You're going to get up on the stand, Johnny, and say she started it? Really? I have never been able to overpower you. That's the difference between me and you.
Why did you try?
And that's the difference that the whole world and that a jury and that a judge will see, is that there is a very big difference between me and you. And all of the people that have come out and lied on your behalf that I can prove as lies, whether it be a text messages that can be authenticated by third-party forensic electronic forensics experts, or if it's audio, if it's photos, there's so much evidence. It blows. There is no reason. There is no reason that all this has come out. But every step of the way, I mean, here, I didn't say anything about security not doing their job or doing their job, and they came out with it. That was a proactive. You not understand that there's a proactive step.
So your dad's a wife beater? You don't think about that, Amber.
You don't think that's also my family and all the death threats that me and every single person in my immediate circle of friends and family is getting also matters? And you think
death threats?
You don't expect that to happen. I've known every step of the way, every single step of the way, everything you give them. You don't think
I'd give them? I'd give them? That's it. I'd give them. I'll see you in court. No, I'll see you in court. I will see you in court. I never said that. I never told anyone that. You trusted me with that, and I've never told anyone that. And you know what, Amber?
Thank you.
This is me. This is me saying, I tried. And thank you, and I will see you in court. You don't want to make nice? I'm trying. But you know what? I loved you for so many years, but you know what? You didn't exist. You don't exist. You're not there. You were a made-up thing in my head. And I can't believe you're doing this to me.
Stop. I
can't believe it.
There's no need to be cruel on top of it. I don't know where...
I know. What I was trying to say is this. Continuing through court is going to end up nothing but bad for you and for me. It's just going to be bad. In any case, no matter whether we ruin each other or not. It's going to be heartbreaking. It's terrible. Let's write a mutual letter that says, look, we, in lieu of what's transpiring out there in the world with all this crazy we've decided to take this private. We're not going to go to court right now over this. We're going to try to work something out together. And then at least, at the very f***ing least, I know you want to respond and I know you want to defend yourself. Listen to me. Defending yourself by throwing someone under the bus is not going to look good. Okay. Have we had fights in the past? Have we had this or whatever? They already know all that. Don't matter. Here's the deal.
No, it matters. You have no idea. Every ounce of my credibility has been taken from. I mean, and done so in a dishonest way. You know,
Amber, the abuse thing is we've got to deal with that. Yeah. We've got to deal with that,
don't
Amber.
I have any way of my credit is my credibility. You know what?
And why did you put that out there?
I did not. You forced me. Your team forced me to by going on the offense.
I didn't force you
from
to.
From the very beginning. I promise. Look up the timeline to these things. Everything is. Forget it. Forget it. You don't believe what I say. You don't believe what I say. But I did not choose this. Every step of the way has been an offense.
I did not put this anywhere. I didn't. Let me talk to the team.
I did not call the cops. I made no statement.
I did not call the cops. You told Io to call the cops.
I did not call the cops, and I did not give them any statement when they put them right to you. I have said only this from the very beginning. I only have my integrity.
Step said, I see the way out, and I'm gonna take it.
Yes, as he was trying to get into the door, I was trying, into the room, I was trying to escape in, he pushed the door into me, and I was trying to hit him by getting him out of the door to stay in the room.
In the argument you had with Johnny on April 21.
Well, what was the question exactly, if you don't mind me asking?
What happened?
She wants to hear you tell what happened.
I was, Johnny and I, when we made it back to our apartment, I was being cold to him. I wasn't being as open or friendly as I normally am. I was crushed. That he missed my birthday, and this is after a month of him not coming home, like five nights a week, just not showing up, or showing up at like 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, or at like 8 o'clock in the morning, I'd find out that he was passed out at one of the other places in West Hollywood. So it had been building up, and so the birthday incident was heartbreaking. It was my 30th birthday. And I just was sad about it. So he asked me, we got in bed and I was just being quiet. I think I picked up my book and tried to read, and he said, what's your problem? And I said, I'm just hurt. And I had been seeing this, you know, I've been trying to get us to see a marriage counselor who said that that's how I should like word things, as opposed to being accusatory. And I said, I'm just hurt that you didn't make it to my birthday party. And then it quickly deteriorated into the normal, it's my fault, why do you always blame me for everything? You always blame me for everything.
Okay.
And then it escalated, and immediately preceded it, but the first big action was the wine bottle that I remember being thrown at me, or maybe it was that I was trying to leave. I don't know.
I think in that recording I made it very clear that I was sorry that the door hit him while he was trying to get into the room I was escaping, or attempting to escape into. And it also misrepresents that what actually happened, which is him trying to get into a room I'm trying to keep him out of. And then he runs the door over my toes, trying to get into the room. I try to push him out of it, which is what the hit is referred to. And Johnny, whenever he was injured or touched at all, always referred to it in these ways of punching or clocked or whatever. And whether you discussed it with him or not, the last thing you do in talking to him afterwards or trying to reconcile with him is to get into what the definition of those words mean to him.
Just say what
happened. So I never even addressed it. If he was ever pushed, it was a cold. He called it a cold clock. I mean, it's just very dramatic.
Isn't it true? Things happened on April 21. At any time after April 21. Did you call the police about these things you say happened on April 21?
No, I never called the police on Johnny myself.
Did you ever report to any law enforcement authority other than the police your claims that he did these things on April 21?
No, I attempted as best as I could to hide this and keep our lives as private as possible, and I did what a lot of, I guess, women do, tried to protect him.
Were you attempting to hide this when you filed this declaration on May 27, 2016?
It was unhideable because the cops had been called.
Ms. Heard, when you claim in your declaration that the argument started with Johnny throwing a magnum-sized bottle of champagne at the wall, do you recall that event?
Yes.
Okay. Did the bottle break?
I don't know if it broke or if there was a bottle on the table next to it that broke and a wine glass next to it that broke, but there was both a wine glass and a bottle. I'm not sure which of the two it was that broke, when the one that was thrown at me but missed, or if it was the one perhaps sitting on the table nearby, but the painting behind it that rests on the wall behind where I was standing still is missing a big chunk out of it. So it made quite an impact.
Are you finished? Did the wine glass you refer to in reference to the bottle ever touch your body?
Pieces of it did. It shattered.
Okay. Where did the pieces you say touched your body touch your body? What part of your body?
I don't remember exactly what part of my body was touched by the glass breaking upon impact. I do know that it touched my body, knees and hands. No, not my hands, my knees anyway. When I went down to the floor, some version of my legs, when I went down to the floor later in the fight, but nothing significant, not like Australia or anything.
No answer.
You don't have to answer it the way she wants you to answer it.
He was about to push my sister down the stairs. She was attempting to break us up. I am protective over my baby sister. When he laid hands on her, I don't know what I did, but I know I jumped in between the actions that I saw could lead to a fatal injury to my sister. She was standing on the top of a flight of the stairs, and she has never hurt anyone in her life, and she does not deserve to be pushed down the flight of stairs. And it looked like she was about to be. And I would have done what anybody who has a child or a sister would have done. I acted defensively in her life. I saw her standing on top of a flight of a stairs and trying to interrupt a fight in between him and I. I don't know what part of my body I put in between me and him and her. But I would have done anything. I would have done anything to prevent her from being pushed down a flight of stairs.
Thank you.
looks. He had the mansion, and you can figure pain. But she was all up tangling in. And up in the fold your hands and close your
I feel like if you have enough hair and enough matching airline pajamas, you're bulletproof.
Let's start with the truth, the cold, hard truth. When a woman comes forward to speak about injustice or her suffering, instead of aid, respect, and support, she'll be met with hostility, skepticism, and shame. Her motives will be questioned, her truth ignored. No matter how terrible or terrifying surviving trauma may be, unfortunately, it can pale in comparison to what follows after. It's no wonder why so many feel they have to remain silent or risk their own safety in effort to protect their dignity by quietly enduring. The fear of being ostracized from your society is just about the scariest prospect there is. But our world is changing. Standing shoulder to shoulder as women, we comprise a vast army of voices, and we can no longer accept silence. I've met so many women who see themselves not as victims, but as survivors, as members of a growing class of women, daughters of a generation of equality. We have inherited far too much to be resigned to accept injustice, and together, we are far too strong to excuse it any longer. I wear orange to say, hey, I hear you. I believe you. What happened is not right. It is not your fault. You are strong. I wear orange to pay tribute to all women and girls who often, at their own risk, share their stories, demand action, call for justice. I wear orange to say stop violence against women. I stand up for human rights. I stand up for women's rights.
More than having her superpower of hydrokinesis, you know, she can manipulate and control water. Aside from that power, the real power that you picked up on is the power that she has inside of her. It is her fierce determination, her drive, her will, her strength, her attitude. When she sees something needs to be done, she doesn't wait for anyone to do it for her. She doesn't wait to be saved. She takes action and she changes it herself. And I like that she fights for what's right. Despite what it could cost her or does cost her personally, she stands up for what's right. And I think, what could be a better example than that? And I started wearing the orange ribbon in support. I started wearing it on the International Elimination of Violence Against Women, which started on November 25th. And on that day is when I started wearing the orange ribbon in support of the UN's campaign for the awareness, to raise awareness and for their campaign of the international elimination of violence against women. And it ran until the 10th, and now we're, you know, in a different stage. It goes until the 10th because that's when we celebrate the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. A movement can be a fad if it's not founded in a deeply ingrained, ubiquitous need. And in order for it to be properly executed, carried, and for us to reap the benefits of it in the wake of these movements, and when I compare it to what I experienced 2 years ago, it is thrilling and inspiring.
She's running for president next year, guys.
You know, 80% of the top grossing films are produced, directed, or written by men. And it's unsurprising that when 15 scripts cross my desk a week, I'm reading one or two female characters that are just characters, meaning they're flawed or interesting, smart, complex. They've got some character. And this week I've read, out of all the scripts that cross my desk, I've read 5 out of 15 that had female characters that really represented one of the varying aspects on the spectrum, the wide spectrum of what it is, what the female experience is. And I'm very inspired and proud to see that change. Now it's our job to go and make them, to keep writing them, to fight for them to be seen, to buy the tickets, to support us, to support each other. We need to not wait for 15, 20 women to come forward before we stop asking what's your motive. Mm-hmm. We really need to realize that if justice and equality is denied to us, one of us, it's denied to everyone. Mm-hmm. And I'm really inspired. I think this is this is changing. I'm seeing it right now just by the number of scripts.
The thing is, your character that you created, Mera,
yes.
Taking on this character, do you realize the impact you're going to have on girls?
You know, Zach Snyder explained to me a little bit of, you're a warrior queen. I went, sword and a crown? Okay.
When I got to L.A., I started working with Amnesty International, where they asked me to accompany them on some research missions to the border, the U.S.-Mexico border, where I was meant to serve as a spokesperson, really to audit, and then later serve as a spokesperson on behalf of the reforms they were intending on presenting before the Supreme Court based on a long-standing legacy of human rights abuses. And due to immigration enforcement and policy around it. And despite the fact that I was meant to merely observe and then later use my platform to draw attention to this issue and these causes, on that trip, my role quickly started to change. As a woman who grew up speaking Spanish, particularly Spanish spoken by the labor working class, the class of individuals with whom I shared a home, a life, a friendship, a childhood, a niñeza. It quickly became apparent to my team that despite their training, sensitivity, and expertise, they were having a fundamental difficulty in getting through to people who were the subject of our research missions. The people who needed it the most. They were having a hard time getting people to open up and share their stories. What we found is the women simply wouldn't speak to us or them. They just wouldn't speak. And so my role was accidentally born. As I would speak to women in my Norteño accent, I found after speaking to one, they would bring over their sister, their friend, more and more women would come to me, every single one, bearing the physical and veritable psychological, physical markings, evidence of abuse, wearing that on their faces, I quickly learned that me, as a woman, with my Norteño accent, was someone that they felt slightly more comfortable in speaking to. Meaning I became the de facto translator and story collector on these trips. I would listen to their stories, and one by one, be introduced to yet another woman who would in turn share hers. And I would listen to their stories of incredible trauma, resilience, bravery, desperation, and hope. And the one thing that I would ask, knowing the futility and the frustrating awareness of the futility of this question, but a question that I could not ask as a human being, what can I do? Me, what do you need? I had limited access to some water, some heat blankets, but I would ask, and knowing the futility of asking, what can I do? What do you need? And the thing that breaks my heart and haunts me and gives me hope is that that response was never, not once, one for money, or independent gain, financial assistance, justice, retribution, immigration help. You know what it was? It's baby formula. I'm speaking to women who aren't necessarily nursing a child. And they're asking me for baby formula. Not just because the many that were traveling, who'd risk their lives, and even harder, risk the lives of their children for a mere shot at a livable life, a livable existence. And the ones that weren't even holding a child, for whom they could not produce nourishment themselves because of the lack of nutrients they had themselves, they were asking because if it wasn't for them, they were traveling with a sister, a friend, there was a woman in their group, and that was worth their one request would be to help her out. And that is something that never leaves you.
I started volunteering at a soup kitchen before school because I didn't have time to do it any other time other than summers. So every morning before school, started going there, and I think that's when I got addicted to the give back, and I learned a lot. I learned a lot about people, and really not what separates us, but really how similar we are. And I moved to LA when I was young. I had no money, as all, starving actors are when they first moved to LA especially. So I looked for ways in which I could be involved, and looked also at the resources I had, and having nothing but time, I wound up finding a way I could work for children's hospitals, or work with children in children's hospitals. And I guess there, well, I still do today, I guess working in those hospitals for me has really taught me the main component of service, which is humanity. Humans are the core component of service. And I think that has translated also into my activism now. Now I have the opportunity to go on missions, as well as, raise attention, funds, support, advocate for various causes and nonprofits. I have the ability to sometimes, participate on these missions. I remember some kids are picking on someone who was, had some physical challenges that the rest of the kids didn't have in school, and they used to make fun of him a lot and had no friends. And I remember I would come home having, I've gotten in so many fights in defense of my friend because I was just it grieved me so much, because I think at the end of the day, some part of me knew, without being able to articulate it in this way, that fairness is fairness for a reason. If it's okay for people to behave in this way to him, then it would also be for me. And I think part of why I feel so aligned now as a champion of the United Nations human rights, sorry, it's hard to say. Part of why I feel in alignment with them is because the basic pledge involves saying if anyone's human rights are denied, everyone's human rights are denied. Then this has been echoed in so many ways by so many leaders and thinkers. And so, for me, I remember, coming home from school and, getting in trouble for yet again another fight. And I remember I was like, I think I said hi or something to the boy I've been defending in school for, sacrificing my one shot at popularity. It never happened anyway, by the way. And he didn't really even know who I was. And I remember being like, what? This is... being so upset. I remember, talking to my mom later on that night, saying how important it was for me still. And because it just felt wrong. But to see it codified, that was amazing to me. And I guess that's why I feel passionate about it. I said, okay, well, I'd rather have the 80 cents and have my job than to lose altogether, not be able to feed and support my family, and have the next person take it for 80, 75 even, who knows. I know it's harder to do the other thing, which is to have asked your boss to have demanded more, to have stood up and said, may I ask what the starting salary for this gentleman was, since we have the same qualifications, for example. So I was just curious, because
2.5 years ago, I wouldn't have thought of it. I have been complaining with this big mouth I've been complaining and talking about this and trying to engage this discussion since I arrived in Hollywood 16 years ago. But in the last 3 years, seeing the energy, the support, the galvanization, the grassroots support that's come up to change the communal cultural conversation and attitude made it possible for me to not even imagine not asking her, what did you do? And she, much to my relief, said, I went to my boss, I demanded more. And I said, and it worked? And she said, oh yeah, it did, but it was not the point. The point was, the harder thing to do was definitely that, I'm sure, is to risk, especially if you are a woman, and I tend to be fine, I'm focused on women's rights and women's issues, but I think that's because there are also men's rights and men's issues as well.
When I started developing a relationship with the United Nations Human Rights, I found, I could not have found an institution more aligned with my core principles or values, an institution that was founded on and serves to represent and protect the articles as set forth in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which I gotta say, it's 70th year today. I mean, so this is its 70th birthday, not today, but this year. And 70 years later, it's just as salient and profound as it was then, it is now.
Wow. We actually have video from one of your humanitarian trips to that refugee camp. Do we want to play that, please?
Need you to check
out
your
So I just finished, it was my first day here at Zaatari. We went to Sam's medical center. Couldn't believe how many people there were in need of real medical attention, and yet everybody greeted me with a smile, and I feel really honored that I could get to know Sam's. I got to actually see the work they're doing. I got to see how much more is needed. I think that's the biggest impact for me is seeing the fight, the spirit, the fortitude and the resilience in the people. You know, and the little girl who hugged me and sat in my lap, who has, you know, a terrible infection for psoriasis, but she was smiling and laughing and giggling with me, and I mean, that, how can that, yeah. That means the world to me, to see it firsthand, see what, where it goes.
Thank you so much.
So, you mentioned your work with the United Nations just now, and I wanted to ask you, when we spoke on the phone about a month ago for a story I was writing, you spoke about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and to be honest with you all here, I don't think I've ever heard anyone more excited about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights than Amber was, and it was contagious, actually, to be honest with you.
It's often said that you came out in 2010, but it's not quite as simple as that, is it? It's not quite right. So tell us what really happened.
Well, I, you know, I always say in response to when I hear someone comment about me coming out, I think it's funny because I was never in, in part because I'm stubborn, I guess, and also in part because I just didn't feel it was wrong. And even though I looked around and realized that no one else was in my position, similar to me, was doing it. And even though everyone around me advised me, strongly advised me against it, it was just wrong. And I would rather, and I would have rather go down for being who I am than to have risen for being something I'm not. And I was in a relationship and I just never hid it. And it was just not important or interesting enough for a long time. And then my career started to change, my life started to change, and all of a sudden, you know, paparazzi would jump out of the bushes, and you know, when that started happening, I would look around thinking, oh, I wonder who's here.
So there was this particular interview you gave in 2010. Yeah. So that was, I don't know, that was stating things sort of formally in a way you hadn't before, at least.
Sure. You know, I like I said, I was always out. I was an activist. I went to protests. I refused to not bring my partner at the time. But no one ever asked me about it. An outlet specifically asked me who I was there with that night and what that person was to me. And I just answered honestly the way I always answered, had there not been a tape recorder on me. And I was just, you know, walking into a, you know, an event, and I answered off the cuff. And I could tell by the look on this person's face that it definitely, well, didn't feel like a big deal to me. Definitely it was a big deal. And the next day, my poor publicist, but, you know, then I realized the gravity of what I had done, and started to understand why so many people, studio execs, directors, advisors, agents, producers, why everyone was so adamant about this not being the label that
right.
comes before my name. And then I saw, as my name became a commodity for this cause or not cause, and then I saw it was attached, I was attached to a label, and I was so allergic to that in principle. I never have seen myself as defined by the person I'm with, the same way as you're probably not defined by the hair color of your partner. It just was not, as somebody who's fluid and human. I never saw myself as defined as one particular thing or not. While my private life is valuable to me, I knew that being in Hollywood, I had a particular responsibility. The burden was on me in a different way than, say, if I had a different kind of job that was less, that had less, you know, public attention around it. And I saw myself as being in this unique position with this unique gift. And as with any unique gift, comes with unique responsibility. And so I just, bit the bullet and called my parents and said, sorry, but you're gonna bye-bye to your private life for a while too. And, you know, this is gonna be a ride, let me do it. And I did. And that's, I guess, what I'm trying to say, is it did impact my career. It was difficult, it was not easy. I was the only one, working in this way, so it was definitely difficult because no one had done it. But I stand here now in 2017, amongst many of my working romantic leading lady peers who are out and leading completely fluid out lives, which is even more difficult than, say, I think even than, you know, subscribe, you know, being a part of one particular label or not. And I'm one of many now, and I'm working, and I'm here today to talk to you amazing people. And I did that even though everyone told me it would end my career, right, without a doubt.
You're one of them, but where are the rest of the people who use their platform to step up for what they believe? Or don't believe.
Yeah, unfortunately, I wish there were more. And that is part of why it is incumbent on those of us that are in the public eye to do with that attention that which is the best to promote the ideals surrounding secularism, feminism, atheism. Because it really is a fight for the at its essence, the what's most important and admirable about humanity. It's our shared common humanity, not our shared creed or the garments we wear. It is about our shared common experience and the information that science provides us to elucidate the world around us and our history and where we come from. We need to come out of the closet and into the light and, you know, move forward with example, just like the gay rights movement. As we've seen, completely change. I mean, I was
I was there before the movement really, you know, kicked off, and I have been, there to watch how it has transformed.
As a woman, having gone through this in the public stage, I have a unique opportunity to remind other women not only that this doesn't have to be the way it is, you don't have to do it alone. You're not alone. And also, we can change this.